Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick, still here in the great state of South Carolina. Just wanted to tell you, praise God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Right? Our God is an awesome God. Hallelujah. Amen. Hey, brothers and sisters, I just wanted to give you an update. I've already ran out of envelopes and supplies, some of the supplies for the anointing oil. Praise God for that. I know that it's going to be a blessing to many people, brothers and sisters, because the Lord told me to do it. So I know that it's going to be a good blessing, just like the book that the Lord gave me to write. I know it's a blessing because the Lord gave it to me. And just like the orphanages, the Lord, you know, gave me stewardship over those orphanages and over the feeding programs. And so I know that it's all good because it's His and all His. It all belongs to the Lord, brothers and sisters. So praise God for that. So I'm going to be looking online to see maybe I can get the, I'm using these bubble wrap envelopes. So all those who ordered them, except for in Australia and in Europe, I have not sent them yet, but all the people in the U.S., I have sent them out. I received some new orders today. Of course, I didn't send those today. The new orders I'll do after I get some new stuff. I'm going to get some plastic bottles instead of the glass ones. I've got the glass ones I sent out. I didn't want to send those to Europe or to Australia, just the U.S. and Canada. So when I get these plastic bottles, and then I need to get more, I'm going to look online to look for maybe some cheaper padded envelopes instead of at the store. Anyway, brothers and sisters, so I'll wait another week or two. Probably it'll take me, you know, get it all lined up. I'll be sending out the next round. So I want to thank all of those who prayed with me over the olive oil, the anointing oil. I put some essence of frankincense and myrrh in there. And this is one of the bottles of olive oil I've been showing on the videos. I've been praying over it every day. And then Brother Sid prayed over it with me. I had another sister pray with me over some of the olive oil also, and then all of you guys who pray with me. So thank God for that. There is power in our prayer, and there is power in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. There is power, powerful, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb too. Amen. That's Jesus is the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. You know, brothers and sisters, while I was just praying a moment ago, I got a Hebrew word from the Lord. And I'd heard it before. I wasn't sure what it was, and I looked it up. And it's really Tekiah, which is a word that the rabbis use when they are, you know, would be a priest in the Bible, in the Old Testament and all that, when they do these trumpet blasts on the Feast of Trumpets. The rabbi will give commands on different types of blasts that they do. There's different kinds of blasts that they do. There's a long blast, and so the Tekiah is a command for a long blast. So as the rabbi or the leader of the synagogue or synagogue, it's a Filipino word for a type of sour soup that's called synagogue. It almost sounds like synagogue. Synagogue, so that's why I get, after being in the Philippines so long that my tongue gets tied up on that word. But anyway, brothers and sisters, there's the different types of blast, and you can look those up online. But the Tekiah is a prolonged blast. It refers to the kingship, really, of the Lord. And it's a call to, you know, repentance and, you know, getting closer to God, getting right with God. And, of course, when you have those feast days and the days of all and all that, which, you know, God commanded the nation of Israel to celebrate, it's really leading them, you know, in repentance and getting closer to the Lord. And of course, looking at it the famous quote is, the Old Testament is, the New Testament is in the Old Testament concealed, and the Old Testament is in the New Testament revealed. So we as Christians, even as Paul said, those who are Israelites who are not born again, they have a veil over their face. Just like Moses wore a veil over his face, so that the glory of God wouldn't be seen by the children of Israel. So they still have a veil over their face. And then if they become born again, then the veil will be taken off their face. But we as born-again Christians, the veil is off of our face. So we can look and see those things for what they are as they point to Christ, point to the events of the tribulation and all that. So as an example, just to say this out there, Jesus, of course, was crucified at Passover. He is the Passover lamb that takes away the sins of the world. He was resurrected on the Feast of First Fruits. The Holy Spirit was given on Pentecost. Then we also, in the Fall Feast, we see that really as related to Israel in preparation of repentance and atonement, the children of Israel are in that process. They're rehearsing and preparing for the return of the Messiah. And for them, it's the first coming of the Messiah. But when he returns and they say, whoops, it was Jesus. Whoops, 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 we've been wrong for 2,000 years. You know, and it says in Zechariah 12:10, they will mourn for the one they pierced, as one mourns for an only begotten son. And that, you know, they will mourn when they see the Lord Jesus Christ. And as Jesus said, you will not see me again until you say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Just like on that Palm Sunday when Jesus went in there and the children and the non-rabbis, you know, the regular people were crying, you know, Hosanna to the Son of David. Hosanna being a Greek word, not a Hebrew word. So they were speaking Greek also there. And they were saying that, you know, it represents Hosanna to the Son of David's victory to the Son of David. And the title Son of David is referring to the Messiah. You know, and that was a common expression for who the Messiah was, even though Jesus corrected the rabbis when he walked the earth, when he asked them, you know, David, speaking by the Spirit, called the Messiah Lord, referring to Psalm 110. The Lord said unto my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool. And Jesus said to the Pharisees, he quoted that Bible verse, and then he said, if David then called him Lord, how is it that he's his son? So David, the Lord Jesus was correcting them when they kept calling him the Son of David. When in reality, he is God. He is the Lord to David. Therefore, in the flesh, of course, he is the offspring of Jesse. But he's also the root, as it says. He's the root and offspring of Jesse. So brothers and sisters, can you imagine how can like a tree, how can something be the root of the tree, but yet also the fruit of the tree? He's the root and offspring of Jesse. Jesse, of course, is the father of King David. Lots of you guys, you've got to read your Bible. You'll see that. You know, who is Jesse's dad? Obed, right? Who is Obed's dad? it's in my mind because I talk about this stuff all the time. I don't know why I got on that topic. Boaz. Boaz and his wife, of course, is Ruth from the book of Ruth, brothers and sisters. Anyway, there's even a harlot in the bloodline of Jesus, Rahab the harlot from Jericho. It's also in the bloodline of the Messiah, Yeshua, Jesus. Anyway, brothers and sisters, so I was just touching on that because the Lord had given me that. So you, if you are interested, look that up. The commands of the rabbi, the calls of the rabbis, or the, you know, the high priest or the priest in the temple to those who would be the what they call cantors, those who are blowing the trumpets on these different feast days. They blow in a sequence and then a minimum of 30, but the tradition, they blow 100 blasts on the Feast of Trumpets. And one of those, a particular type, is called a Tekiah. And then the last trump, you know, as Paul refers to the last trump, you know, for the rapture, the last trump is Tekiah Gedolga. I'm probably not pronouncing that right. Gedolga. You know, it's the final blast, and it's a prolonged blast that goes on and on and on. That is the last trump on the day of Feast of Trumpets. So there's Tekiah is the one I'm saying, but then on the last one is Tekiah Gedolga, which is just that one final blast. So, but those, all the other ones are the other three or four different kinds are all, you know, repeated in the sequence, as the rabbi would call, you know, give the command for the trumpet blasters to do those different types of blasts all through the day and all through the ceremonies that they do. And God has all of those things, brothers and sisters. And in those things is hidden the church, hidden the New Testament, hidden Christ is hidden in all those things. Even like on Passover, you know, they hide, you know, they hide something there, and then the children try to find it. Well, that is even, you know, represents Christ being hidden, and they're trying to find it. You can do a whole study on all of those things, brothers and sisters. I used to study all those things a lot back when I was first getting started. And it was really so interesting and intriguing to see how You know, the Lord Jesus is hidden in all of those things, all the things in the Old Testament, brothers and sisters, are pointing us to the Christ, to the Messiah, the one and only, the only begotten of the Father, the Lord Jesus Christ. Brothers and sisters, I want to tell you, the Lord has also spoken to me about pastoring a church here in the U.S. for the next 3 years, or for a total of 3 years. And the Lord had given me a word about pastoring a church. Actually, in 2003, the Lord had given me, a word and a vision that after I went to the Philippines, when I came back, I would pastor a church for 3 years. And I had written that down in my prayer journal. And, I thought maybe I had misunderstood the Lord. You know, I mean, because I'm back and then I haven't heard anything about it. And then just 2 days ago, the Lord reminded me of that it was right. So, brothers and sisters, I know that, what the Lord tells me and what the Lord would lead me to do is nothing to do about setting, when the rapture would be or not be. You know, the, no man knows the day or the hour. That doesn't mean that the rapture will not be next week. But, brothers and sisters, I would just want to say this again in all, common sense. Since I started on YouTube, and of course, my call and my ministry from the Lord for YouTube is to prepare people for the rapture. You know, and just like that Tekiah that the Lord just gave me is a call to repentance and prepare for the Day of Atonement. You know, prepare as for Israel to prepare to meet the Messiah. But for us also, of course, if you're born again, but we still need to maintain a repentant life, and then we're still prepared to meet the Messiah, but not at the second coming like Israel, but at the rapture. Okay, brothers and sisters, so since I've been on YouTube in July 2011, and the Lord had talked to me about writing a book and all these things, and I told people in the YouTube video, I said, hey, the Lord's leading me to write a book and all that. I had several people, every time that I'll say, hey, the Lord is leading me to do ABC, there are several people that always message me, say, oh, don't worry about it, just forget about it, because you know the rapture is going to be any day. You know, start talking about anything after today, and the people just, you know, start saying, oh, well, the rapture is going to be, just forget about it. No. The Lord said to occupy till he comes. We're supposed to go forward and do all that's in our heart to do from the Lord, to do his will, to build his kingdom, just like the orphanages and all that. I don't listen to any people or any man or woman that tells me, oh, you don't need to worry about building orphanages. The rapture's going to happen. You know, and then there are, you know, people that do not believe in the pre-tribulation rapture who will mock and say, why are you building an orphanage if you believe in the pre-tribulation rapture? Because the Bible says, Jesus said, no man knows the day or the hour. That's why I'm doing that. And then secondly, even more importantly, because the Lord told me to. That's why I'm doing it. The Lord has led me by Spirit. For the Bible said, those who are led by the Spirit, these are the children of God. So the Lord has led me by His Spirit to build the orphanages. You know, to do the anointing oil, to write a book, and then a second book. I'm going to write, by the grace of God, the Lord told me to write a second book. So I'm going to do that. And barring, if the rapture happens, it happens. You know, and then it won't matter. We don't sit around staring at the sky all day long waiting for the rapture. Jesus said, look up, you know, but not sit there and stare at the sky. We still have to keep laboring. We still have to keep working until, you know, it happens. And it could be years from now, brothers and sisters. I know that, you know, that's not the what people want to hear. But the rapture could be years from now, brothers and sisters. There's no guarantee that it'll be tomorrow. All the people who are on YouTube setting dates and telling you all these things and doing all these calculations is just a futile waste of time. You know, and I have lots of people asking me, you know, to look at these kind of things and go review. And all the numbers add up, Brother Patrick. It's got to be right because all the numbers add up. You know, the people have been setting dates since I've been on, you know, on YouTube. And I really got started on the YouTube 2011. People have been setting dates. But the thing is that the thing about it is, brothers and sisters, the input numbers they're using are arbitrary. They're just picking numbers from all different locations. The Bible doesn't say to go take the number of what day President Obama got elected and how old he was, and he was the 44th president, and he Kenya is at the 38th parallel times the square root of the parallel of Washington, D.C. You can take all kinds of things and calculate out, you know, all you have to do is take Algebra 101, and then you can have an end result number. I want the rapture to be on the Feast of Trumpets 2015. So I'll sit down and write down that date, and then I'll, you know, get minus today's date and calculate exactly how many days it is. Let's just say it's 300 days from today. So I come up with 300 days. Now, you know, it just so happens, whatever, that 300 is divided, whatever, by the age of Obama, it comes out to be whatever it is. And then, you know, multiply. It's just, you can use an algebraic formula to calculate anything you want, brothers and sisters. I challenge you, if people have not taken it off the internet, go back and look at people who have set dates for last Feast of Trumpets, last year, all these different dates. Go back and look at the calculations they have. They are using numbers that they pulled out of a hat. They pulled them out of the air, brothers and sisters. There's no basis. There's nowhere in the Bible is there a basis to use the numbers that they're using. Brothers and sisters, anybody can take any numbers and come up with any kind of a date they want. That's what I'm trying to tell you. The Bible doesn't give us directions. People are, you know, just running with it. It's nonsense. Do not waste your time and energy with these calculations. I'm telling you, you are totally wasting your time, brothers and sisters. Don't let people get you caught up in that stuff. You know, just go on and serve the Lord. Do all you can for the Lord. And just like the old army slogan, you know, be all that you can be. You know, I'm being all I can be for the Lord, for the Lord's army going forward. And that's all you can do, brothers and sisters. You know, stay repented, walk with the Lord, you know, read your Bible, pray, worship the Lord. You know, if you go read in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, where it talks about the rapture, you know, the Lord descending from the air with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first, and those of us who are alive and remain shall be caught up with them to meet the Lord in the air. Therefore, we will be forever with the Lord. You know, therefore, comfort one another with these words. The next chapter, chapter 5, Paul keeps going on, and he's saying what to do in light of the fact, you know, that we're going to be going home soon. You know, and Paul wrote that 2,000 years ago, but those things are still applied to go today. Go read 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. I've done a video on it before. You know, pray without ceasing. You know, making, you know, merry in your heart, praising the Lord, worshiping the Lord. You know, carrying on a joyful fellowship with our brothers and sisters in Christ. All those things. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I'm just making a video, just talking. You know, kind of just like a fireside chat without a fire. I'm actually oceanside. I'm having an oceanside chat with you guys tonight. Praise God, brothers and sisters. Praise God for God's. Praise God through whom all blessings flow. Praise God, all ye creatures here below. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord God Most High. I mean, you know, there's, you know, once you, the thing about it, that when I do that in the videos, because the Lord's leading me, brothers and sisters, just like any spirit-filled Christian, you know, we're releasing, it's releasing that anointing. You know, and I heard someone say this before, you know, the Holy Spirit comes up and on us, upon, it comes up out of us, out of our belly with a river of living water. It comes up on us, upon us, like you, what is this, upon, you know, like the word upon, U-P-O-N. So the Holy Spirit comes up and on us when we begin to worship Him and praise Him and talk about Him. So, you know, whenever you're in any situation, you start talking about Jesus, about the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. You start talking about His blood. You start singing praises to His name and all that kind of stuff. You know, that the Holy Spirit begins to move in that. As the Bible says, the Spirit of the Lord inhabits the praises of His people. So as we praise Him, singing is not always singing. You can praise Him by talking about Him. You know, Jesus is the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. He is the Most High God, Creator of heaven and earth. Hallelujah, praise be His name. There is no other name given under heaven where men might be saved but the name of Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Messiah. Hallelujah. Blessed be His name. Hallowed be His name. Hallelujah. His kingdom come, His will be done on earth as it is in heaven. You know, as you would begin to speak those things, the power of God moves in those words. Those are His words, not mine or yours. When we speak His word, His Spirit moves with that. Holy angels move. The Bible says that angels move in accordance with His word. So brothers and sisters, you know, they respond to His word. So when you begin to speak His word or sing songs from His word, and praise His name, that's when the Holy Spirit moves, brothers and sisters. So when you're in a situation, you know, it's you know, I could do a video on this. This is the tradition. Let me talk about this tradition. As I'm going on and on about this, the tradition is, well of course, the Bible tells us when Joshua and the children of Israel are about to cross the Jordan River, it says that that Joshua told the priests there, the Levites who were carrying the ark, he told them to step into the Jordan River. And when they stepped in, as they stepped into the Jordan River, the river banked up. You know, it became backed up, and it left the land downriver dry, so the children of Israel could pass over. But it didn't stop until they began to step out into the Jordan River. Now the tradition says that what happened with Moses, it says in the Bible that he held up his rod, you know, and then a wind blew all night, and then the Red Sea parted. If you read that in the book of Exodus. But the tradition that they say is that Moses actually walked into the water to nose deep in the water. To the water was almost about to drown him, as deep as you could go and still stand on your feet. And then, as he began to pray, you know, and hold out his staff, then the water parted. So what I'm trying to say is, these two are an example of how, you know, and there's many more Bible verses to support this, that after you begin to open your mouth, after you begin to praise Him, that's when the Spirit responds to you. You know, lots of people are waiting on the Lord. I should make a video about this. I've already been talking 20 minutes and now I'm getting a good nugget from the Lord. You know, lots of people are waiting on the Lord to move, but the Lord is waiting on you to move. You see what I'm saying? The Lord is waiting on you to move. And when you begin to step out in faith, then the Lord will be there to catch you. Just like Peter, when he got out of the water, got out of the boat and stepped on the water. I mean, you know, he had to take that first step. Can you imagine? People are just so, you know, what's the right word? Arrogant, prideful, full of septic tank pumpings to realize that, you know, and like I say, I've heard several people talk about, yeah, Peter, he got on the water, looked at the waves and he sank. Yeah, old Peter, he was pretty up and down in his faith. Excuse me, I challenge you to get out of a boat. Take that first step out of a boat and get out onto the water and take a step. I challenge anybody, even myself, to go do that. You're going to go step on water? Come on, man, don't even try it. Don't even try it. Now, if the Lord Jesus himself was out on the water, it's a whole different story. But see, Peter and those guys knew in the spirit that, you know, that he was the Christ, the Son of the living God. But still, he hadn't been glorified yet. They weren't filled with the Holy Spirit. You know, and they were still, you know, not 100%, you know, sure that who is Jesus and what is he? And, you know, what's the deal? You know, I mean, this guy's a prophet for sure. Is, you know, and it seems like he you know, he's something more than that. But, you know, the fact that, you know, he's God in the flesh, they were still trying to get that in their mind. Unlike us today in the New Testament, post-resurrection, post-Pentecost, you know, we know who Jesus is. You know, we have 2,000 years to support that. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I'm not really saying anything in this video. This is my Seinfeld video. It's a video about nothing. God bless you guys. You know, I wanted to come on here and talk to you guys, even though the Lord hadn't really given me, you know, a specific great message. I just wanted to come on here and talk to you guys because, you know, I just want to commune with you, even though the best I can through the internet. I ask you guys to continue to pray for the orphans. We've been having trouble with the van at the orphanage. We've had to get the engine repaired twice. Of course, it was, you know, the vehicles, you can't hardly get a new vehicle in the Philippines. And the vehicle that we got a good price on it. But it had been, you know, like a taxi in Seoul, Korea, used, you know, or some kind of cargo van there in Seoul. And so we got it as a surplus, and that's most vehicles in the Philippines. And so, you know, we've had to get the engine repaired. So that's why I'm praying about whether we should sell it, try to get a better vehicle, you know, a newer vehicle, even though it will cost more. If we keep repairing the engine, that's, you know, we spent like close to $1,000 getting it repaired, the engine repaired twice with some replacing two pistons. So, you know, it seems to be that it's a money pit. So I ask you guys to pray about that. Because maybe we could just get a new van. but it would be a whole lot more expensive than what we paid. I guess a new van would probably be at least $20,000 or something, whereas this van, I think we paid $7,000 for it. So, you know, vehicles are expensive in the Philippines. They have a huge limit on importing, of course. Look, all of these third world countries, you'll find out, are very corrupt. You know, only the politicians, you know, the local mayor's kids go to private school in Switzerland. How many mayors make enough money to send their kids to Switzerland to a private school? You know, this is the kind of country that you're dealing with. So, you know, we have to do the best we can. So I ask you guys to pray about that. You know, pray for all the things of Joshua's ministry in the Philippines. I need to make a new report about the ministry there. But anyway, guys, God bless you guys. And I will see you soon. By the grace of God, we will be raptured out of here. We will meet in the air. I pray that it is so, brothers and sisters. I pray that it is so, even today, even tomorrow. But I am not I'm not quitting the work that the Lord gave me to do on earth. I'm going to continue to go forward as if I'm going to be here for the rest of my life. How many ever years the Lord would give me on this earth, 40 more years, so, or whatever it would be, by His grace. I'm ready to push forward, brothers and sisters, and do all that the Lord would have me do. And I pray that you guys would also do that. Be rapture ready, but yet continue to go forward. But, you know, like I always say, you know, the thing is that, yeah, we've got to live our secular life. You know, if you know, you have your obligations, you got a family, got a house payment or whatever, and all those things. Of course, you know, we have our earthly obligations that we are committed to. And the Lord expects us to do that. The Bible says that if you don't, you know, take care of your family, you're worse than an infidel, the Bible says. So, yeah, we are commanded to take care of our family. There's lots of people that become Christians and they lose their mind, and then they, you know, they want to be a monk, but yet they're married and got a family. You can't be a monk. You know, God expects you to take care of your family also and yet serve Him. Now, if you become a Christian and you don't have a family, and that's a whole different ballgame. You know, then you can, you know, make all these commitments to serving the Lord. But most people, like myself, being married, that, you know, you have to maintain that balance of spending time with your family, taking care of your family, and yet didn't spend all the time you can ministering to the Lord, serving the Lord, doing His will and all that. So, you know, this is the case that most people are in. You know, we have to have that balance in our lives, brothers and sisters. And that's something I've talked about in many videos. But by the grace of God, I'm still planning on, you know, going to all the places that the Lord told me to. I'm just waiting on His timing, when to go to Seattle, Dallas, all those places, Nashville. I'm going to go there as the Lord leads me. And I'm praying right now, though, because the Lord has spoken to me about pastoring a church. So I ask you guys to pray about that if you want me to be in your area. Like, as an example, Nashville, Dallas, Arkansas, Seattle, whatever. All those places, California, whatever. I mean, it's up to the Lord. It's all great with me, whatever the Lord wants to do. I love all you guys. I wish that we were all in the same place, but, I mean, that's the disadvantage of YouTube. You know, I have people who I talk to who are in all over the world, which is totally cool. It's something that's only in these last days, you know, that I can chat with someone in Scotland, you know, and be friends with people in Scotland. At the same time, someone can watch this video in Australia, you know, South Africa, whatever, you know, and other African countries, France, Germany, all those places, just totally cool. Canada, U.S., Mexico, people in Mexico, South American countries too. Praise God. It's all nice. It's really cool, you know, to talk to people around the world. So I thank the Lord for that. That's the good side of the internet and the one world things that's coming, is that we can make friends all around the world. And our brothers and sisters in Christ. Anyway, brothers and sisters, if you want the oil, you know, I'm going to keep going as the Lord has led me. Just go to the website, you know, or email me. And I'll be able to send you some prayer oil. And God bless you guys. God bless. God bless.